Here in St. Mary's Welwyn this morning. I also have Lyndon and a small choir, and as you saw, Colin Hull is with us too, who will be preaching this morning on this second Sunday of Lent. Unless statistics dramatically change over this week, the intention is from next Sunday we will be back in church as gathered worshipping communities. Those of us, of course, who feel comfortable doing so. And so, unless you are from St. Giles Coedycut, we're having a slightly different pattern of worship, so do check there with the intentions. But the rest of the churches from tomorrow will be open as usual for our normal pattern of morning and evening prayer and the weekday communion here on Wednesday at St. Mary's, with all of the usual precautions in place that we've become used to over this last year. But for those of you who prefer still to be staying at home, we will continue to live stream as we have been doing from a different church each week. I hope you have sight of an order of service. It's on the Welwyn website if you would like to find that. Our first hymn for us this morning has been recorded by Joe Fossard. And so you can join in and sing How Deep the Father's Love for Us.
That he should give his only son.
sacrifice of God is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart God will not despise. Let us come to the Lord who is full of compassion and acknowledge our transgressions in penitence and faith. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And the collect for this second Sunday in Lent, let us pray. Almighty God, you show to those who are in error the light of your truth, that they may return to the way of righteousness. Grant to all those who are admitted into the fellowship of Christ's religion that they may reject those things that are contrary to their profession and follow all such things as are agreeable to the same, through our Lord Jesus Christ, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever. Amen. First reading comes from the book of Genesis. When Abraham was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to Abraham and said to him, I am God Almighty. Walk before me and be blameless, and I will make my covenant between me and you and will make you exceedingly numerous. Then Abraham fell on his face, and God said to him, as for me, this is my covenant with you. You shall be the ancestor of a multitude of nations. No longer shall your name be Abraham, but your name shall be Abraham. For I have made you the ancestor of a multitude of nations. I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and I will make nations of you, and kings shall come from you. I will establish my covenant between me and you, and your offspring after you throughout their generations, for an everlasting covenant, to be God to you and to your offspring after you. God said to Abraham, as for Sarai, your wife, you shall not call her Sarai, but Sarah shall be her name. I will bless her, and moreover, I will give you a son by her. I will bless her, and she shall give rise to the nations. Kings of peoples shall come from her. This is the word of the Lord.
God.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. The promise that Abraham would inherit the world did not come to Abraham or to his descendants through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. If it is the adherents of the law who are to be the heirs, faith is null and the promise is void. For the law brings wrath, but where there is no law, neither is there violation. For this reason, it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his descendants. Not only to the adherents of the law, but also to those who share the faith of Abraham, for he is the father of all of us. As it is written, I have made you the father of many nations. Abraham believed in the presence of the God who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist, hoping against hope. He believed that he would become the father of many nations, according to what was said, "So numerous shall your descendants be." He did not weaken in faith when he considered his own body, which was already as good as dead, for he was about 100 years old, or when he considered the barrenness of Sarah's womb. No distrust made him waver concerning the promise of God, but he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, being fully convinced that God was able to do what he had promised. Therefore, his faith was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now the words "it was reckoned to him" were written not for his sake alone, but for ours also. It will be reckoned to us who believe in God, who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead, who was handed over to death for our trespasses, and was raised for our justification. This is the word of the Lord.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus began to teach his disciples that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly. But Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him and said, "But this surely must not happen to you." Jesus replied, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If any of you want to become my followers, then let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who live their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel shall save it. For what would it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them shall the Son of Man also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you.
And may Christ be upon my lips and in all of our hearts. Amen. Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit confer together before the beginning of all creation. The Father says, "Let us make a world, and in the world we'll have cause some human beings to exist who will be filled with our love and with whom we will have communion. When humanity has reached a certain age, we will select a man and a woman who will give birth to nations, through whom we will reveal the full extent of our love and life to other nations. And in time, my son, you shall be born among them. The infinity of your life joined with the finite body of a human being, and you will be the focal point of unity and of all things still to come." Then said the Son to the Father, "But Father, if they are free-willed, they may go their own way. They may defy us. They may not follow the pattern of our love and life. The father replied, "Then, my son, that will be your second mission. While you are among them, we will bear the price and heal their wrong. And you and the Spirit will lead them back to the future that we had prepared for them. So at least some, will find the destiny we have made them for." I give you that story, maybe an imagined story, but I have to believe to be the great story behind the whole of the Bible and the Bible's traditions. Today in our readings we have two stories that are part of that greater story. We have the story of a man and a woman, Abraham and Sarah. And then we have part of the story of Jesus, the incarnate Son of God, God and man in one being. Abraham and Sarah are the people that God starts his great plan with. But it's a very strange choice of people, because if these people are to be the bringers of a whole generations of new human beings, well, they're both very old. When Abraham is first called, he's 75 years of age, and Sarah probably not much younger, and they have no children. He's asked to travel from Ur, the Chaldees, which is somewhere in Iraq, I understand, and travel west to the land of the Canaanites, given the promise that he and Sarah will give birth to great nations. Paul says that that belief made Abraham righteous, a good character, and that Abraham fully believed it. I'm afraid Paul has forgotten part of the story. For in chapter 16, the one we had before, which is 11 years after Abraham's call, Sarah says, "I don't think we're going to have any children. Take my slave girl Hagar and have a child through her." And Abraham does. But God says, "That's not what I intended. You and Sarah will have children." In the reading today, Abraham is 99 years old, and he and Sarah still don't have a child of their own. And when God promises it, Abraham laughs. And a little while later, when Abraham and Sarah entertain three visitors from God, Sarah laughs. Maybe that faith was not as unwavering as Paul tries to make out. But perhaps we can sympathize with Abraham. After all, he's been waiting for 25 years for this promise to be fulfilled. But even so, God still loves him. God still uses him. God remains true and constant to his promise and plan, even when Abraham and Sarah do not quite believe it. It was not much better with their descendants. There's a whole history of the failures of the people of God. Believing, but not quite believing. Sometimes following, but often not. God gives them the law, but they don't always follow it. The law provided societies which would be equal and mutual and full of the divine love. but instead there was inequality and injustices. God is constant and merciful. The people of God are not. And then the coming of the Son. As God planned and promised his Son to become into the world with the human nature of Jesus, the greatest part of the plan from the very beginning. Will disciples of Jesus be any better than those who have gone before? They have some faith, but also they lack faith. So Peter, Simon Peter, loves Jesus. And of course he wants to protect him. He wants to see Jesus becoming the Messiah that he believes him to be. And then Jesus says, my way is going to be a matter of suffering, and I'm going to die at the hands of the religious authorities and the Romans. And so I'm just, sorry, that can't happen to you. Jesus says, get behind me, Satan. You're not thinking the right way. You're not thinking my way. Later we know in the story that Simon promises, I'll die with you, even if other people forsake you. Then we know what happens after that, when it gets tough in the garden of the courtyard of the high priest, when asked three times if Peter has been with Jesus, is that I don't know the man you are talking about. And all the other disciples, where are they? Well, at least all the men folk have run away in hiding. Not a very promising start for the disciples of Jesus. But Jesus loves them. He still wants to use them. The church grows throughout the Roman Empire. After the resurrection and Pentecost and the receiving of the Spirit, Simon and the other disciples are the great ambassadors, and they spread the good word. And yet, the church still falls into various forms of failure. There's not the unity among the people. There's not the unity among nations that God wants his church to be. Injustices and inequalities remained in the church and have done so down the centuries to our day. When people belong to different churches of different races, and huge inequalities of wealth and privilege, which have happened down the centuries and are still present today. We have seen in the history of the church bloodshed simply because people have had a difference with other races and other nations. Continued slavery and persecution of those who are different. God still loves his church. God is love, and God is constancy. But often the people of Christ are not. And of ourselves, each week we say a confession as we acknowledge we have both faith and lack of it. Love with limitations, but God still wants to use us, and God is love and mercy and constancy even when we are not. He still comes to us with open hands of forgiveness. He still makes us look at the world and say, how may you express my love? Over the next few weeks, some of us will be following a Lent course. A Lent course which is about the various crises in the world, the needs of our country and the needs, indeed, of the whole planet. Can we in our generation be the people who will try and continue to put right that which has gone wrong? How will we let God use us to put right some of these things? How will we play our part with Christ and the Spirit who lives in us to bear witness to that eternal love that wants to make all things new?
So we now affirm our faith in God, the eternal life, using the words of the Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious Father, we thank you for that overarching story of your love, the story that brought Christ into the world to share in our troubles. We pray for your church in this period of Lent. Grant your disciples the strength to grow in discipline and holiness, that by walking in the way of your cross, we may lead others to the joy of your saving love. We pray for your church across the world, for all Christians who face persecution, rejection, or imprisonment for their beliefs. We pray for our own Church of England as General Synod meets this weekend. Bless those conversations as the Church listens and debates. We pray for our own church communities in the Welwyn Team. Pausing now for a moment to pray for our individual congregations and for these coming weeks and months as we begin to regather again as church communities. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As General Synod reflects on the housing crisis in this country, we pray, loving Father, for the 8 million people who live in inadequate housing, for all who are homeless, in hostels or on the streets, for those whose housing is cramped, for those whose homes are places of abuse rather than safety, for those whose homes are unsafe, and thinking amongst those of all who live with the anxiety of unsafe cladding after the Grenfell disaster. In Christ, you pictured heaven as a large house with many rooms. Help your church show your welcoming love through generosity and practical action, so all may have shelter and safety and a place to call home. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving Father, you called Abraham and Sarah to be parents of many nations. We pray for your whole world, and particularly for all Jews, Muslims, and Christians who recognize themselves to be children of Abraham. As we come to you in prayer, turn our hearts to see your life in one another. Pray for all places where neighbour has turned on neighbour, where war and violence divide communities. Bless the peacemakers and turn the hearts of all who hate to know your love. And as our Lent groups this week reflect on exploitation of human labour, we pray today for all those trafficked and enslaved, for all stripped of value and human dignity. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving Father, we bring to you all who are frail or sick and those who minister to them. We remember the residents and staff of our local care homes, hospitals and hospices. We pray for members of our church communities, families and neighbours who are in particular need of God's comfort, healing and strength. And we pray too for all who have died, for those dear to us, and particularly those whose lives have ended within these difficult times of restrictions. And as we think of Captain Tom's funeral yesterday, with just his closest family in attendance, we remember too the many, many families this past year who have been denied the close comfort of supporting friends. And we lift them into the love of God. Loving Father, we know you come close to us in our grief and sorrow. Reveal yourself to all who grieve, so they may know the hope of your eternal kingdom, where tears and pain and sorrow will be no more. Merciful Father, Accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given us access to his grace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. You might want to offer a sign of peace to members of your household. Peace to all of you over there in the choir. Right and good to give you thanks and praise, Almighty God and Everlasting Father, through Jesus Christ your Son. For in these 40 days you lead us into the desert of repentance, that through a pilgrimage of prayer and discipline we may grow in grace and learn to be your people once again. Through fasting, prayer, and acts of service, you bring us back to your generous heart. Through study of your holy word, you open our eyes to your presence in the world and free our hands to welcome others into the radiant splendor of your love. As we prepare to celebrate the Easter feast with joyful hearts and minds, we bless you for your mercy and join with saints and angels forever praising you and singing.
Holy, 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 Lord God of heart and mind.
Send your Holy Spirit, that broken bread and wine outpoured may be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. On the night before he died, he had supper with his friends. And taking bread, he praised you. He broke the bread, gave it to them and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine. Again, he praised you, gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence, his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross. Bringing before you the bread of life and cup of salvation, we proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Jesus Christ is Lord. Lord, by your cross and resurrection, you have set us free. You are the Saviour of the world. Lord of all life, help us to work together for that day when your kingdom comes and justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favour on your people. Gather us in your loving arms and bring us with the Blessed Virgin Mary and all the saints to feast at your table in heaven, through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All honour and glory are yours, O loving Father, for ever and ever. Amen. Amen. As our Saviour has taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body because we all share in one bread.
Jesus,
takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. So as we share in the bread this morning in church, you might just like to use this time to pause at home and make your own prayer of spiritual communion. together. Almighty God, you see that we have no power of ourselves to help ourselves. Keep us both outwardly in our bodies and inwardly in our souls, that we may be defended from all adversities which may happen to the body, and from all evil thoughts which may assault and hurt the soul, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Christ, give you grace to grow in holiness, to deny yourselves, take up your cross and follow him. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. O my God, in you I trust. You are the God of my salvation. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. In you I hope all the day long. O my God, in you I trust. Remember, Lord, your compassion and love, for they are from everlasting. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. O my God, in you I trust. Go in the peace of Christ. Thanks be to God. And our final hymn, 40 Days and 40 Nights. Thank you.